Hello everyone, welcome to JCL training series. In this video, we are going to look into the job statement in detail. Welcome.
Hello viewers, those who have not subscribed our channel, kindly do subscribe our channel. And for any corporate trainings, please reach me through my email or WhatsApp or through Facebook. Now let's get into the job statement. So the JCL statements are of three types. There are three main important JCL statements. The first one is job statement, the second one is EXEC statement, and the third one is DD statement, and the least important is null statement. So in this video, we are going to look into the job statement in detail. So the job statement. So job statement is the beginning of a JCL. Job statement comes in the beginning of a JCL. Here I have boxed in red. So this is the job statement. So any JCL, in any JCL program, starts with the job statement. So this is the first statement in any JCL. Job statement is the first statement in any JCL. It identifies the beginning of job to the OS. So OS will identify it as a job by looking at the job statement only. If this statement is missing, then your job will not get executed. If this statement is not there, the job will not be executed at all. So the JCL statement has four fields. So my first field is two slashes, which begins at column 1 and 2, and the next field is job name field, and the third field is job field, which is the operation part, and next is the operand part. Operands may be positional or keyword parameters, and the last part is comments. So any JCL statement or the job statement will have this. The job statement will have the following fields. First two are slashes, and then job name, then the job keyword, which indicates the operating system that you are going to process a job. Then the next thing is operands, which are positional and keyword parameters, and the last one is comments. So what are the parameters, what are all the parameters that will be present in the job statement? So job is a parameter which we definitely will be present. So it is it specifies the job. Then the next one is the name of the job. So we have to name the jobs meaningfully. So for example, backup job should be named as backup job, and for clearing data sets we have to name accordingly. And the third parameter is accounting information parameter. The fourth parameter is programmer name parameter, which indicates the name of the programmer who has written the code. And the fifth parameter is class, so it is for categorizing the job. And the next parameter is message class parameter. It specifies the output class, it specifies the output class to the job log. And the next parameter is message level parameter. It specifies the, it specifies to which printing system the output should be routed. And the next parameter is priority parameter. So it describes about the job priority. And the last parameter is type run parameter, which is used to scan or hold a job. So we are going to see all this in detail. So first one is the job name. So job name must begin in column 3 following the double slashes, which is present in 1 and 2 columns. So we have certain rules for coding the job name. So job name should be of 8 characters in length. It can be only up to 8 characters in length. It cannot exceed 8 characters. So we have to name meaningfully. So job name can include alphanumeric characters. It can include either alphabet or numeric characters, and it can include these national characters. So hash, at, and dollar are called as national characters or national symbols. These characters can be added in our job name. So the first character of the name, the first character of the job name must be alphabetic or national. So our job name should start with an alphabet or the symbols. It cannot start with numbers. So these are some examples of valid job names. So it can begin with alphabet. Here also it is beginning with alphabet. So this is fully alphabetic. Here it is fully. So it is, here it is alphanumeric. Here it is having alphabet, numeric, and national character in it. Here it begins with national character. Here it is having alphabet and numeric. So these are some examples of valid job names. So it starts at column 3. So first two slashes and next it starts at column 3. So next we are going to see the positional parameters in job statement. So there are two positional parameters in job statement. One is the job accounting information parameter and the second thing is programmer name parameter. So the first one, job accounting information parameter. So as its name indicates, accounting in the sense for billing purpose. So this job consumed how much CPU time in the mainframes. That can be found using this accounting information parameter. So this is the syntax for accounting information parameter. So it can be enclosed in braces, account number, comma additional accounting information. So it can have two fields in it, account number and additional accounting information, which can be enclosed within brackets or it can be enclosed within single quotes like this. Simply you can put the account number alone, simply you can code the account number alone, or simply you can put a comma and you can give the additional accounting information without giving the account number also. So these are the ways in which you can give the accounting information in the job statement. So here 1, 2, 3 you can see this job statement. In the brackets it's given as 1, 2, 3. So this is the accounting information here. So these are some examples for accounting information parameter. Here you can see A123. So this is account number. Here we have only account number here, and in the next example we have account number as well as additional accounting information. This is the development department or additional, it is an additional accounting information. So this will be used for billing purpose. And here we have only additional accounting information is there, so the account number is not there. So this is also valid. So all these three examples are valid. So this is how the accounting information should be coded. So next one is the programmer name parameter. So the programmer name parameter, as the name clearly indicates, so the name of the programmer who have coded this JCL can be given in the in this particular parameter field. So it specifies either your name. If you are a programmer, it will specify your name and information related to the job being submitted. So the length, so it can be up to 20 characters in length. It can have 20 characters. The programmer name parameter can be of length up to 20 characters. And second thing is the special characters such as blank, comma, single quote, asterisk, dollar sign, plus, minus, equal sign or brackets. So these special characters must be enclosed within apostrophes. And one important thing to remember is hyphen cannot be embedded within the programmer name parameter. So you cannot code a hyphen in the programmer name. That is one rule to keep in mind while coding the programmer name parameter. So again here you can see Ganesh enclosed in single quotes. So this is the programmer name parameter. So this is account information. So this is programmer name parameter. So the next, so this is the programmer name parameter here. So next we are going to see the keyword parameter. So earlier which we discussed two things, like accounting information parameter and programmer name parameter. So these two are positional parameters, followed by that is the keyword parameter. So keyword parameter must follow the positional parameter. It cannot precede the positional parameters. This we should keep in mind. So the following keyword parameters we are going to discuss here. So class, priority, message class, message level and type run. So first one is the class. So class parameter assigns a job class to a job. So it is nothing but a classification of a job, whether the job will run to a short time or whether the job will run a longer time, or it whether it will require more resources. So such classifications can be done using this class parameter. why this classification is needed. So it is to inform the operating system how much CPU should be provided, how much time should be allocated for this job, how much resources should be given to this job. So it is just an instruction to the operating system, like this job comes under which category. So that indication is done through this class parameter. So class equal to job class. So class equal to job class. So it can be, so this job class can have values either A to Z or 0 to 9 values. So it is again machine dependent. It is machine dependent in the sense it is dependent upon your workplace or your work environment. So in some environment, in some workplaces, it will be configured as A to Z in the server side, and in some places they might have configured as 0 to 9. So the next parameter is priority parameter. So this is related to the class parameter. So this is related to the class parameter, like so we are submitting two jobs of the same classification or same category. Out of these two jobs, which job should be run first? So that priority can be given through this parameter. So priority can be any number ranging from 0 to 14 or 0 to 15, depending upon your job entry subsystem used by the operating system. So it can be a number ranging from 0 to 14 or 0 to 15. So a job with higher number, a job with a higher priority number takes precedence over a job with a lower number. So here we have in the example given below, job 1, job G123, and here we have given priority as 10 in the same classification, class A, and again in the another job we have class A, and this priority is 1. So the job with priority equal to 10 will take precedence and it will run first. So this job will run first, and after the completion of this job only, this job will get executed. So in the same category, which job should run first is decided by this priority keyword or the priority parameter. So the next parameter which we are going to discuss is message class parameter. So the message class parameter determines the output device to which the system messages and JCL messages are written. So after submission of the job will bring out output and system messages. It will bring these two messages. So the output will be maybe routed to a printer directly. So for example, if a report is generated by a job, and that report needs to be given to a higher official, in such cases they will route the output directly to a printer. So the printer will print that report. So this message class decides to which output device the output should be routed. So output class name equal to A to Z or 0 to 9. If Z is a printer in our work environment, so the output will be routed directly to the system printer, or 0 to 9. So again, all these values are configured according to your work environment. So the next one is message level parameter. So message level parameter is used to specify the JCL and allocation messages which will be recorded on the output device specified in message class. So once a job is submitted, the following messages will be generated. One is the log messages. Log message will have indication about a job name, username, and output device. And JCL statements of the job, JCL statements of the job will also be generated once the job is executed. So log messages will be generated. The next one is JCL statements will be generated. Then messages related to the execution of the job will be output, like data set information, data set allocation information will be generated, data set deletion information will be generated at the end, and regarding the job execution, if the job is executing at step 1, that messages will be displayed in the output. Again, when it is executing at step 2, step 3, until step until the last step, all the step execution also will be output. It will be printed in the output area. Then again, the output of the program, is running, taking an input, and it will generate an output. So that output also will be printed. So all these informations messages will be generated once the job is submitted. So we can control this information, whether we need all the JCL statements or not. We can control it, whether we need messages related to the execution, we can control it. So we are going to see the syntax. So message level equal to statements comma messages, or message level equal to statements. Without giving messages, we can just give statements, or message level equal to without giving statements, we can give comma messages. So the statements can take values like 0, 1, 2, and messages can take values 0 and 1. So if we code 0 in this place statements, only messages related to job statement will be output. So JCL information, procedures, symbolic parameters, those things will not be printed. Only job related statements, job logs will be printed. Other JCL statements won't be printed if we code statements as 0 here. And if we code statement as 1 in this place, in the statement place, if we code statement as 1 here, all JCL will be printed. If the JCL is having a proc or procedure, it will also be printed. The symbolic parameter will be substituted with values and it will also be printed. And if you code 2 in the statements place, it will print only the JCL. So it will ignore the job related messages and other messages. It will just print the JCL alone. And messages, in the messages part, if you code 0, only allocation or termination messages being output. So allocation and termination message will be output if the job terminates abnormally. Only if the job is fails, it will be printed, otherwise it will not get printed. But if you put messages equal to 1 here, in this place if you put 1 here, allocation or termination messages will be printed whether the job fails normally, or if it is executing, if it is executes normally, or if it is abnormally ends. Regardless of whether the job executes successfully or fails, all the messages will be output. So this is about a message level. So it may look vague at the beginning. When you are executing the code, you will come to know about it. You can change the values for statements and messages, and you can go check the spool area. The next one are the last parameter which we are going to discuss in this job statement is type run parameter. So type run parameter is used to specify special type of job processing. So we can hold the job processing by putting a hold, type run equal to hold. If you put type run equal to hold, the job execution will be halted in the sense the job will come to the queue, it will not get executed, it will be on hold until it is released. And if we are coding a type run equal to scan, what will happen is the job will be scanned for JCL errors. So the job will be scanned for JCL errors, and this is about type run parameter. So any doubts, any queries, or any suggestions, any feedbacks, you can post it in comment. All your suggestions are most welcome. Please like my channel, subscribe my channel, and share it with your friends. Any improvements, please let me know. Thanks for watching this video. Thank you.